Okay, we've been talking about real growth, putting off childish things. You know, our foundational scripture, of course, is 1 Corinthians 13, 11. When I was a child, I spake as a child, thought as a child, understood as a child. But when I became a man, I put off childish things. And then I spent some time sharing with you the dream that my wife had about the changing babies that didn't want to be changed because they had been burnt before. Or the babies that were caught up in the womb that was stuck in the womb, but they needed to be released. They needed to be birthed. But actually, we had some time. I'm gonna take a little side journey. Guy talk. Saturdays at 10 o'clock, from 10 to 11. But we were talking about shattered dreams, and we were saying how a lot of times people go through shattered dreams because God is trying to get them to the dream. See, that's something that we're willing to do. You know, something that we're good and we're comfortable with that. But God has something that he's designed for us to do. So a lot of times he'll shatter what we decided to do because he's trying to make room for what he wants us to do. So he'll shatter the small dream to get you the big one. So we was talking about that. We was talking about, oh, there's always something wonderful waiting. Oh, just let go of that. Give me that. I'll take that. You know how you give something to a kid, you know, or they're in the store and they pick up something that they want. But you got something you was getting for them. And you go like, oh, no. That's not for you, baby. That's not for you. And, nah, I want this. And they be holding on, right? You're like, no, you gonna have to give me that right now. No, but I want this. But no, but I have something better. I don't want that. I want this. Because they don't understand the value. They can't properly appreciate or assess what God really wants them to have. So a lot of times that's why things are shattered in our life. Like sometimes those relationships are shattered because God's like, are you kidding me? You're joking, right? This is not like, you don't want this, do you? And you're like, yeah, but I want this, you know. But a lot of times you don't really want it. It's just, well, at least it's something. Because again, going back to an improper image of yourself. So you have improper image to yourself, then you'll settle for something that's less than yourself deserves. You see what I'm saying? So but God has a whole lot more for you than that, right? All right, so we're going to park over here because we talked about sanctification. So we talked about setting your heart to hear from God. So we talked about hearing from God, but then we talked about setting your heart, sanctification. I want to set myself to hear from God. So we're going to park on sanctification today because we're growing up. So if we're growing up, putting off childish things, sanctification, you know, we're excited about sanctification. When we hear the word, we're like, that's what I've been looking for, sanctification. Man, I just couldn't wait for sanctification, right? So last week, I believe I gave you 1 Peter 3:15. It says, sanctify the Lord in your hearts. Purify your heart so you can hear from God. And James chapter 4 says, draw nigh to him, he draw nigh to you. So you're setting your heart. You know, the scripture says, set your affections on things above in Colossians. So it's I'm locking in to something now. It's what Trina was talking about and what Hallie was talking about. You know, like, okay, I kind of been around God, but now I'm about to lock in. So I'm not just going to be around. I'm not just going to say, hey, I acknowledge God. I'm not against God. I'm not going to talk negative about God. Now, living for God might be a little different, but God, yeah, I'm cool. I can go to church on Sunday, stuff like that. You know, that's cool. But as far as communion and having a relationship where I'm hearing from God and the steps that I'm taking are obedient steps to take me to fulfillment, because the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. I'm listening to God every day. I'm not just doing what I feel like because I can. See, sometimes we can just, you know, I have some friends with their resources. They can just do what they want to do. But see, I'm not just doing what I want to do. I'm being intentional. I'm not wasting any moments. I'm maximizing my time, redeeming the time, because I'm growing up. I'm not a child. See, people, remember we talked about your right to your right of accountability and responsibility. She is cracking me up. She's running back and forth. All right, so we talked about the age of accountability. So when you receive, oh, this is my son who I'm well pleased. This is my daughter. She's ready to rock and roll. But that means you growing up. Now you're not playing no more. Now you're intentional in your choices. We talked about this morning in Luke 14. You know, it says, what king goes out to war? He has 10,000. the people he's going to fight is 20,000. Who goes out to war and don't receive any counsel? Don't measure that thing out. Now that's further down in Luke 14, but early in Luke 14, it says, who builds a house and don't count the cost? Who builds a purpose and a dream and don't measure and count the cost? Who gets involved in a relationship and don't consider who they're getting involved with? Who detaches the behavior from the person? Who does that? Kids do that. You know, I had kids come in my office for counseling with a parent, actually. They didn't go to our church in Ohio, but this young lady would come to counseling every week. I don't know if she's on the call or anything, but she would come every week, ever since she was like 13 or 14. Parents said, we go to a church, a bunch of old people there, she needs help. So she was coming every week, just constantly come every week. So the number one problem was the people she was around. But she was childish. So she was just childish. She didn't know any better. So she hit me with what kids would say. She was like, but they cool. You know, my mom tripping. They cool. I said, okay, they cool. I said, let me ask you something. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? You know, I gave her like the church line. Is your personal Lord and Savior? She was like, yeah. I said, oh, so you going to heaven? She was like, yeah, I'm going to heaven. I said, where they going? I never looked at it that way. Oh, I said, oh, so you got you a ticket to heaven. You hanging around them, and it's okay that they cool, but you ain't sharing Jesus with them. These your friends, though. You ain't going to talk to them about Jesus, because if you talk to them about Jesus, they might not be your friends no more. So you don't care where they go? I never thought about it that way. The next week, she brought all her friends to church. The next week, she brought all her friends to church. See, you know what she did? She decided to grow up. Consider her audience. Consider the people she was around. So we have to do that too. Y'all probably doing that already. For the people that ain't doing that, that's going to watch the video, y'all probably very intentional in who you're around. See, we want to play. We want to. I played basketball in college and I played a fraternity. And somebody might be listening to this, but it's the truth. I know some people still back there in college. We ain't in college. I mean, I pledged a fraternity, but I'm Alpha and Omega now. I ain't gonna blast the fraternity. You know, I mean, like, and I run into brothers, I'm cool with them. We cool. One lives out here that actually plays where he lives in Monroe. Play basketball together, we play together. We talk from time, he's a Christian too. We talk from time to time, but that's not what my life is. See, because I'm growing up. When I pledged the fraternity, why did I pledge? I pledged because what? Because I was thinking about purpose? No, I was thinking about playing. That was the draw. Yeah, I know I'm married now, but that was the draw. The stories I heard was playing, partying, and some other things that I'm not going to mention right now. That's why I pledged. Like, really? That looks like a good deal right there. You know what I'm saying? So it wasn't for purpose. So now I'm moving towards purpose. I can't hold on to playing and get to purpose at the same time. I got to grow up, right? You know, I'm married. I can't just be like, then you could call me. That was my reputation. You could call me anytime to do anything, and I'm there. Matter of fact, this is a terrible confession, but this is what I used to say. I'm down. 3 o'clock in the morning. Yo, Keith, we're going to the club. So I'm down. Like, you almost didn't even really need to ask me. Because I took pride in that. If you call me at any time, I'm ready to go. And that's what, anytime, for anything, at any moment, I drop what I'm doing, I'm gone. See, but I can't do that now. Somebody can't call me 3 o'clock in the morning and tell me we're going to a club. I'm married, and I ain't going to a club. You see what I'm saying? I put away childish things. I don't do those things anymore. I'm growing up. Now, of course, I'm a little older, but I'm just saying, are we taking steps to grow up? Or do we still want to play? Are we being intentional? Are we maximizing our moments? That funk, that weight that be creeping up on you, keep knocking on your door. Remember we talked about the depression always coming to the crib like he lay there. You know, you was watching a movie. I can't think of the name of the movie, but the young lady was a trainer or something. It's called The Trainer. Okay. Well, the young lady was a trainer, and so the other young lady didn't want training no more. It was she fitness. So she didn't want training no more. So she was just like showing up. Like wherever she was at, grocery store, job. Like showed up at the job, was like, well, you know, you said you wanted to lose 10 pounds and I haven't seen you. She was like, well, no, I'm good. She was like, no. She pulled out a contract. Did you sign this? She said, you signed this, so you know you're gonna lose 10 pounds. So she was like, everywhere she went, this person was there. Like, she was like, no, I'm good. She was like, no, you're not good until you lose those 10 pounds. Then like, okay, she met another young lady. She met a guy. So the trainer was like, well, the guy is distracting you from losing your 10 pounds. So she killed him. Then the girl in the grocery store was mocking her. She was like, everything in your cart is not conducive to you losing these 10 pounds, right? So the girl that was with her was like, oh, we don't have everything. She opened up the, you know, where you get the ice cream, you know, in those big gallons. She said, oh, we forgot something. Bam! You know, just trying to pick with her. Well, she killed her. No, she didn't kill her. She ran her off the road, and she ended up, you know, running into a bus or something, right? But look. She signed on for training. She wouldn't let her go. That's what depression be trying to do. Like, you'd be like, no, I'm done with you. I'm done. Depression be like, no, what you mean you're done? Did you sign this contract? Just be showing up everywhere. At the job, at the grocery store. You'd be in the car. Depression be like, yeah, so I was thinking that we could change the music to more of a sad, you know, I can't believe this happened to me. You know, like, why don't we put, like, some breakup-type music? You know, like, you know, I mean, you deserve to be cuddled right now. You know, that's what depression be doing. Now, we're trying to go past all that stuff, right? Aren't we? But the key is sanctifying ourselves, setting ourselves apart. And if you read through the Bible, you read through Leviticus chapter 10 and some other things, God had the law first mentioned. That's what you call it in the Bible. Law first mentioned is, where did it begin? Like right now, there's some argument about marriage. Just go back to the law first mention. That was God's intent, right? So that's all you got to do is law first mention. Where did everything begin? So sanctification started back in Leviticus. And God was pretty serious about that. Like, even when they was bringing the Ark of the Covenant out, somebody touched the Ark of the Covenant, which represent the presence of God, that person would die. You had the priests, which we're called Levites, but you had the priests. When they were set apart to serve in the tabernacle. So this is where we get our, what we call baptism now. So people would come with a lamb or a turtle dove or whatever represented that sin, and they would come oh, I'm gonna pick with somebody today. All right, so they would come to the brazen altar. And they would come to the brazen altar. They would make the sacrifice, and that would create a stench of death, right? So then the priest would go to the brazen basin and cleanse himself of that stench. Then he would go before the holies of holies, right? That's what he would do. So what we do, we present our bodies as a living sacrifice, right? Then we go through baptism, right? And then we come before the presence of God. So now in the tabernacle, anybody couldn't take the sacrifice. Had to be somebody that was sanctified, set apart. So it was Aaron and his sons. So everybody else could leave the tabernacle, but Aaron and his sons couldn't. So if they left the tabernacle, they could die. So think about it. There was other people outside the tabernacle. They didn't die. But once they were set apart, sanctified, they had a whole nother responsibility because they had to go before the presence of God, the all-consuming fire. So they couldn't have any contamination in them at all. See, so when we lock in and we set ourselves to commit to God, we can't be exposing ourselves to stuff. See, when you're ignorant and you're naive, you expose yourself to things because you don't know any better. You're a child. But when you grow up you recognize accountability, you recognize, okay, this is not good. So now you start to expose yourself to stuff. It don't have the same effect. You know how, like, there was a time it seemed like you could make mistakes and it was like a lot of grace, like, well, I did the same thing they did, nothing happened. But then, did you remember when you crossed over, it seemed like every time you do something off, every time you outside the line, something crazy happened?